Good day, my name is Joan Badasirayi, your facilitator for customer service relation management. We'll continue today with this. Customer service relation is very key in every organization. Customer care is the process of building an emotional connection with customer. And there's also what we call customer service. Customer service is the provision of service to customer. So the difference between customer service and customer care is one is provision of service, while the other is ensuring customers' satisfaction. So you say, why is customer service important? You see, think of companies and organizations that give great customer service. We all have our favorites, and some may disagree about one of their choices because they have had bad experiences. Some of customer service factors that may affect our choices may include, like when you are buying goods, you look at the freshness, the quality, the quantity of the product, helpful and friendly staffs. These are some of the factors that actually make our choice. Then we have very high standard of hygiene for places like eateries. Customer care results in high level of customer satisfaction, leading to long-term buying relationship between suppliers and consumer. So like I said before, so what is customer service? The process of delivering high quality service to internal and external customers. Organizations that provide high standards customer care tend to have the following characteristics. One, that will be high quality products or services that represent value for money, high standard of after sales services, friendly and helpful staffs, a positive response to customers' inquiries and demand, a can do rather than can't do approach, a regular appraisal of the services they provide in order to improve that services, and the ability to be self-critical in a positive way. So, we started with why customer care is important. Because you assess all these things and you know that for every organization to actually grow, that's why they look into customer care to give customer satisfaction. Then the call center experience. When we have a problem, we want to deal with someone who is honest, friendly, reliable, knowledgeable, trustworthy, and can solve our problem quickly. Yet, our day-to-day experience with other companies and organizations doesn't actually give us these qualities that I just listed. Some annoying stuff about call centers. They make you want to wait before talking to you. They make you choose from options before talking to you. They play music. We're all used to that, especially with our telecom companies. They try to direct you to their website to solve your problem because it saves them money, make it difficult to solve your problem. They tell you how important you are, but don't treat you as important, as if you are important. You never talk to the same person twice, They insist you repeat information unnecessarily. They don't employ enough staff. And they don't care. This is not only applicable to call centers alone. People in retail environments are often rude and unhelpful, not because they are bad people, but they are often poorly trained, badly managed, and often working under pressure. To deliver excellent customer care, it requires commitment from the top of the organization, investment in training and equipment, and proper management is an ongoing basis. It requires feedback from poor customers and staff that are experiencing the services and suffering at the same time. Reasons why customer care is very important. Most companies will always tell you, we are totally customer focused and our customers are our greatest asset. How true is that? Highlight from CBI, that's Confederation of British Industry Surveys 2009, concluded that only one customer in 10 with grants of compliance actually do so. A lot of time when we are not satisfied, we just get angry and some of us don't go back to such places. We don't go and complain, and the company don't get to know about all these things. So, but when there is a customer care center or that customer service relation, so of course the customer knows where to go and lay his or her complaint. Although in some banks, you dare to see a bus is provided for complaints, but this one is only one customer in 10 actually go and drop a complaint there. Then those customers who experience problem tell between 8 and 10 people about the problem, whether or not they are formally complained. That's it. You go to the bank, you see somebody will be angry, I will be shouting, I will be explaining to other persons that are on the queue. They keep telling other people about it. So, and that way, at times, such things always also bring the image of such organizations down. Then 9 out of 10 people who complain and have a problem, this is dealt with satisfactorily, will buy again. When you complain and they attend to you and actually help you, it makes you to actually have confidence in the company. In fact, they rate the supplier higher than if the problem ever occurred in the first place. So 9 out of 10 who complain and have a problem that is not dealt with satisfactorily, we never buy again from that supplier or do so at the very last resort. It costs 5 times more to attract new customer than to keep an existing one. This is very key. So this is what most people don't know, surely people that work in big organizations like the bank. So they're like, if you just come, I want to close my account. Some say like, who cares? If you want to close your account, you can close it. But they don't know that it takes more time to bring in more customer. So it's better you keep your existing one by taking care of them. Say, who is responsible for customer care? Who is responsible for customer care, customer service? A lot of time in most organizations like the bank, they just leave it to the customer service officer alone. No. In an organization, everybody, say customer care is everybody's responsibility. You should begin with the most senior in the organization, e.g. the managing director. Then it should be embedded into the organizational culture. Customer care training should not be limited to supervisors and staff alone. Everybody in an organization has the potential to upset customer and get in the way of providing excellent service, customer care service. The responsibility of the senior persons in the organization is to give leadership and explain that customer care is at the heart of decision making for the future. So we see customer care is very, very, very key. It's a case study on an hotel where is an hotel. It has this rice cutting hotel group, has 73 hotels worldwide and employ 38,000 people. They are fanatic about giving great service. Here is how they explain their benefits to their staff. Rice Hotel is a place where the genuine care and comfort of our guests is our highest mission. We pledge to provide the finest personal service and facility for our guests. We'll always enjoy a warm, relaxed, yet refined ambience. And the motto of that company says, we are ladies and gentlemen, serving ladies and gentlemen. This motto exemplifies the anticipatory service provided by all staff members. It's a three steps of service. Service, a warm and sincere greeting, it is very key. You see, when you go to most of our banks, they say, welcome to this bank, welcome to that bank. Some are really friendly, especially the security men, but you don't get to get that from the front desk officer, even especially the customer service officer, because they are so busy and tense. By the time you even greet them, it's difficult for them to respond. So you use the guest name, it is also good. Like for me, if I go to a bank and the cashier's name is on the desk, I like addressing them by their name. The anticipation and fulfillment of every guest needs. Then fond farewell. As a customer service officer, by the time you start attending to the customer, but a lot of time what they do is say, sir, sir. But if you know, look at the name on you, you can address the person by his other name. Then the person knows that you're actually working with he or her. Then give a warm goodbye and use the guest name. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. This, for doing business with us. It is very key as a customer service officer. So, setting goals and standards of performance. It is very important that every organization knows how to measure the service being given. Examples of how customer feels depend on the service being given. You have those that are angry, that are dissatisfied, mildly irritated, indifferent, quite pleased, happy, and ecstatic. Which of these do you think will benefit your business most? You understand? So, although ecstasy is probably going to be at the top of most people's list, it is unlikely to be achieved in the long term. In the long term, it's difficult to achieve because you see all angry, dissatisfaction, mildly irritated, indifferent, quiet, pleased, happy. Ecstasy, that's the highest. But most of the time, people only get angry, dissatisfied, mildly irritated, and quite pleased. They don't even get to happy. So how do they achieve that? It is not enough to say things like we want our service to be as good as possible. How will you know well you are doing well? See, examples of standard and performance could be everyone takes responsibility for answering the telephone. Then everyone not allowed ringing more than 4 times before being answered. This one, when you call most of our network providers, the phone will keep ringing, 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 ringing. So you'll be wondering who is to pick this call. At times, they don't get to take your call. Then the person answering the call should take responsibility for solving the problem. That one is another difficult part of it.
Then we have standards of performance to be effective should be achievable. When you are measuring your standard of performance, you must look at things that are achievable, measurable, ambitious, relevant. Then we have time bound and consistent. You don't just state standards that are too high. Achievable standards that are impossible to achieve will become demotivated and people will stop trying. To be most effective, standards should be agreed by people responsible for delivering the service. And the member of staff is something that you know that they can actually achieve while reflecting the overall needs of the business. They're measurable. When you're looking at that, see, whenever possible, standards should be capable of measurement. This, when you set standard, this measure can be monitored in order to show how well they have performed. So you don't just set standards that are unmeasurable. Something you can measure, then you will know that these people are actually, if you say enthusiasm or friendly, they are important to include in the list, but don't expect to be able to judge yourself or your department against this. If you want to know whether you want, how do you measure friendliness? So those are the things you look into. Then we have ambitious. You say the standard we set ourselves, the more we will achieve, the higher the standard, the more we will be able to achieve. If you have high expectation for yourself or low expectation, you will tend to not be disappointed by the outcome. So generally, individuals, teams, and organizations that set ambitious standards tend to do best. So we also have relevant. You see, standards of performance should relate to the needs of your department and its internal and external customers. It would probably not be relevant for members of department who had no physical contact with the public to set themselves specific standards of dress unless those standards form part of the company's culture. If standards are not relevant to the need of the department and its customers, it is likely they will not be carried through. Then we also have time band. The standards must be time band. Standards of performance will change over time. What is relevant today may be totally unsustainable tomorrow in the future. So technology technology also change people's expectation. So standards, therefore, should be regularly reviewed. Then we also have consistent. While it is important for members of each department to set high standard of performance, there is also a need for consistent standards to be set centrally that we apply throughout the organization. Identifying your customer and walking the walk. The first question we need to answer is, who is our customer? And this is very key. Because a lot of organizations, maybe a lot of times, so actually, let me just cite the example of a bank. They tend to pay more attention to the high-rate customers, and they don't do that to the other smaller customers, forgetting that the smaller ones put together, it also helps the organization. So everybody that comes to an organization, that comes to do business with that organization, is a customer. So in order to provide a consistent level of customer care, we need to identify who our customers are. We have the internal and external customers. When the internal customer refers to the staffs and members of the organization, their various departments, their roles, and welfare in delivering excellent customer service. Then we have external customers referred to the customers outside the organization. Also, customer care begins by putting the initial decision to be different and place service at the top of everyone's agenda.
For an effective customer delivery, the following questions need to be asked and answered. Where are we now? Where do we want to get to? How do we get there? That is our strategic plan. Once these questions are answered, our customer care strategies need to be reviewed on a regular basis. This then leads to improvement in the service level, which are then implemented. This is then implemented repeatedly on a continuous basis. So you must look at improve, you implement, you review. Many organizations try to implement customer care program that fail. You understand? So a lot of time, customer care is very key. Putting customer care program into practice requires training staff and communicating with customers a lot, but it requires resources and need ongoing management, measurement, and review to bring long-term beneficial effects on the customer. So we end our class here today on customer service relation, and we'll continue the other part during our next class. Thank you.